Chicago house music.
When you really want to dance and you really want to go ahead and find out, you look at somebody in the corner and you find somebody dancing. That's just a circle itself. It's from the heart. Because why? Whenever you go out, you want to take that same attitude that you had when you went to the garage, at the loft, and bring it to where you're at today.
That was a short clip from the 2003 documentary titled Maestro, directed by José Ramos. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening. My name is Stephen Hicks. I am a writer slash music lover slash crate digger. Today we're joining in partnership with the New York City AIDS Memorial as co-hosts of their new conversation series, A Time to Listen. This program is presented by the New York City AIDS Memorial, which was conceived as a place to honor all the people in New York City who have died from AIDS, as well as to commemorate and celebrate the effort of caregivers and activists in our ongoing response to HIV. The memorial that was planned was an on-site project for spring 2020 called Hear Me, Voices of the Epidemic. Conceived as a sound installation, Hear Me will be made of audible moments from the historical and ongoing response to AIDS in New York City. From oral history to news clips, found footage to dance songs and much more. Hear Me will be the second project under the Arts and Education Initiative, which was started as an important step to creating a living and breathing memorial. This project is currently on hiatus or pause due to COVID-19 crisis. However, the postponement has provided time and space to delve deeper into how we find, choose, and curate content for the installation from both historical and contemporary sources, resulting in a time to listen. We hope to install Hear Me this fall 2020, and of course, we'll keep you posted as the installation is confirmed. The topic for today is going to be rooted on the dance floor and the sounds and the culture of New York dance music and its intersection with HIV activism. So we're talking about disco, boogie, modern soul, freestyle, house. When we talk about activism, some of the names we may throw out will be the Gay Men's Health Crisis and ACT UP. We want to capture the stories from those who were there and those who got the party rocking. And so today we're joined by two guests, Krishna Stone and Danny Krivit. Krishna Stone is the director of community relations in the communications department at the Gay Men's Health Crisis, GMHC. She originally connected with GMHC in 1986 and has been on staff since 1993. She works to organize community events such as rallies, press conferences, dance parties, fundraisers, panel conversations, and trainings for people all over the world. In addition, she is a huge, huge disco music lover. Danny Krivit, our other guest, is the world-class DJ and a legendary key player in the history of New York nightlife, and most definitely one of the very few people who can honestly say he's DJed in all the hottest clubs in New York around the world for the past 50 years. He's also known as the king of the re-edit, I have two videos that I want to share that I think might really bring home the significance of Danny's career and of Krishna's impact. So I'm going to start off with the video about Danny's career, produced by Thump.
I still think New York City is fantastic and alive with so much. But if I have to compare it to my beginnings and what it was like then, it certainly was a violent and dangerous place, but it was very much more alive, a lot more artistry around, a lot more freedoms, a lot of expression. It was a golden period. The music industry was in a lot better shape.
I come so far with a mind, my side in laser difference. Oh, well.
This was typically our handball court. We could get up to 5 players in this area. And a lot of these guys were very good. And Nile Rodgers was one of them. He played with me here. At the time, Nile was completely a Black Panther. And every day I saw him, he was wearing army fatigues.
I'm Danny Krivit. I'm DJ now for 45 years. I guess I'm best known for the music that I play. It's very diverse, but it's bass and soul. And I also have a good reputation for editing. When I started, you were also starting to see what they call machine gun edits, where you would have this, I'm going to show you I can edit technique. I was much more into an edit that extended what you liked and lent itself to thinking, is that an edit? It sounds like the music to me. I'm just trying to find the best in things, and there's a lot out there. Moved about 10 blocks in my life. I grew up in Greenwich Village. My father was Chet Baker's manager. My mother was a jazz singer.
As a kid, when I lived on 12th Street, I would walk almost every day past here. This area was very depressed. This whole park was this huge prison. It towered over the entire neighborhood, and it kind of kept everything down. There was no money in this area. There wasn't going to be. Because of that, it attracted a lot of artists and musicians and the gay population. It was perfect for them. And when they tore it down, within a few years, this area became the poster child for co-ops.
My first DJing was for my father in 1971 when I was only 14, but for a place called the Ninth Circle.
All right, so here we're at the Ninth Circle. I've worked there as early as 7. I would set up the bar in the morning. The Ninth Circle had a reputation for this hot music. When you go in there, you'd hear music that wasn't the top 40. You'd hear these album cuts and a lot of hot jazz. I served Janis Joplin there a couple times. I met John Lennon, Yoko Ono there. I met Jimi Hendrix there, Charles Mingus. I made tapes and they used them here. I really didn't think of this as a job. So my record collection was pretty much supplemented by myself, other jobs I had, and that's how I started DJing.
Besides these records, I probably have about 80,000 in total. The rest is in 4 storage rooms. I've had them since the 80s. The collecting thing, I think, started before records. I'm kind of a chronic collector in life. That's what pulled me into music in the first place, was collecting the records, owning the records.
This is, it's called Yellow Sunshine. It's a Philly International release. It's the members of Instant Funk. This is their first record. And the song Yellow Sunshine was one of those early break records, you know, that you would hear guys cutting up in the parks.
It's such an ideal format. 100 years from now, this record is going to sound just the way it does today. It has a life. And I can't say that about digital music. You have to constantly update it and copy it. It can lose something. The first edits I did, to get them right, I handled them so much with my hands that you start to hear them get dull. Over the years, I made the move to digital. It was an important improvement to use digital. But I always prefer vinyl. It sounds better. It's something tangible, and I enjoy playing it. People relate to seeing that. There is a little bit of romance with the 7-inch, especially since I try to collect these ones with picture covers. It adds another dimension to them.
These were all DJ Flower 7-inches, his original stuff from the early 70s.
and someone kind of bestowed that on me.
They're a single. They're very focused, often a short version, but a very concise, no frills, just the meat and potatoes of the song. And they actually sound very good. There are many highlights I could point to. Certainly my introduction to the loft and the garage, they were the mecca of the best DJs and really what I considered the best music. It turned me on to a lot of things. When I played for roller skaters, it brought me into another world as far as really following a groove and another type of music. And this was right around the time disco was falling apart, so it was a good stabilization for me. Larry Levan was a very influential person in my career. I met both Francois Kay and Larry Levan at the Loft in the mid-70s. And Larry, when he started the garage, I really gravitated there. That was my home base, and loved going there almost every week. I worked a lot in the 80s, but in the 90s, when I started with Francois Kay and Joe Corsell for Body and Soul, that was a big turning point. That was a different way of playing, really playing for the fun of it, and yet it became a big success. And then after Body and Soul closed its weekly party at Club Vinyl to play my own party, 718 Sessions. 718 Sessions, it actually started in 2002. The premise of these parties, both Body and Soul and 718, it's built on the heels of these other great parties before it, the ones we respect the most, which would be the Loft and the Garage and Shelter and, you know, places like that. I really relished the idea of the way I control those parties and how they turn out the way they are. I do have a number of things I want to focus on and celebrate. One is, since it's 45 years, I thought I would really focus on playing a number of parties where I just play the 45s, the 7-inches. A 2-hour set of 45 seems like a full night. It sounds like it's very focused and quick moving. If you're watching DJ play 45s, it's very engaging. You see stuff happening all the time and they're doing something. And it's very rewarding. They make for a very fun format. You know, I'm focusing on releasing more music. In today's life, standing still is like moving backwards.
Mention AIDS in this day and age for black, young, gay people, or people of color in general.
Gay Men's Health Crisis is the world's first AIDS service organization, founded in 1982 at the height of the AIDS epidemic, at a time when we didn't know what AIDS was. Today, we are a $33 million organization that serves more than 13,000 people each year through a number of programs, including hot meals, legal services, mental health services, substance use services, HIV testing and prevention. And we also fight for fairer policies at the federal, state, and city level.
We all have this energetic thing in us, and we're all educating ourselves so we can educate others.
I came here to go to FIT, and within 30 days, I was homeless. So since I was homeless, I decided to take the streets on my back. I knew nothing about New York City, and then came into GMHC, and I accepted their services. I was diagnosed back in 86. So finding a women's group and being in a women's group at GMHC and having like pantry, someplace to come and get food and stuff like that, that's what really helped me.
Everybody deserves this kind of AIDS, HIV prevention information. And we, as the House of Latex, can show up and share this information. And that provides power in the communities of the houses, the power of knowledge.
You can't talk about HIV and AIDS without talking about the intersectionality of homophobia, transphobia, poverty, mental health and substance use issues, lack of support from family, lack of education, lack of jobs. And these issues are driving new infections in specific populations, such as young Black and Latinx gay and bisexual men and transgender women of color. It's not to say that the rates of infection has stopped in white gay men or straight women, but these particular populations are still disproportionately impacted by HIV and AIDS. It's really mindful to look at all of these issues and figure out the ways to engage people in dialogue in a safe and non-judgmental
way. So thank you all. So this afternoon, we're going to have a few questions and really just try to have a down-home conversation, very casual conversation. But I'm coming to you all because as a music lover, as someone who's worked in public health, I've floated in various intersections, whether I was carrying crates for DJs or DJing myself or being on the dance floor having dance battles and sweating all night, or if it was my 9 years working in HIV. And so I feel like I'm sitting at the feet of giants, and I want to hear more about the stories and more about your experiences in the intersections of music and in HIV, public health, and cultivating culture and cultivating community. And so first, I want to ask if you all could take turns in describing what New York was like in the mid-70s,
sure.
late 70s.
You want to hear from me first? All right. I don't know. You know, we take for granted now the internet has kind of spread everything out. But in the 70s, you had to be in the city to be in the center of things. And all the things you were describing and all our experiences, you had to be in the city to get that. And especially in the 70s, I mean, the city was pretty down economically. So, there was a lot of crime and drugs, but there was also a lot of freedom, especially in the arts and music. And so you saw a lot of new clubs opening up and different places that could really show off artists and musicians and clubs and things like that. So city seemed really alive. I think that was For me, the big difference in the 70s, it was very happening. The 80s kind of went through a transition, moving closer to where we are now. A little more control and less freedoms. It was funny, in the 70s, they said there was maybe 2,000 clubs in the city that had cabaret licenses. That meant there was probably another 2,000 that didn't. So all these clubs were packed. I mean, they were really happening, all of them. And really just a few years back, I had asked about how many cabaret licenses there were, like, and it had gotten down to like maybe 40. And out of those 40 cabaret licenses, those clubs were struggling. It's hard to maintain a club in this atmosphere and these rents and rules, and it's very different. And I guess it's hard to even imagine it now, how vibrant it was then in comparison to now, which a lot of people don't even really go out to the club and think they did. They just see it on their phone, and that was enough. And they think that they've experienced the whole thing, and they really haven't. It was an incredible experience to be out in these clubs. That was my take.
So I graduated from high school in 78, and I came to New York City to go to NYU and then also to become an actor. Well, I was acting before then, but just to continue being an actor. However, I fell in love with all the different clubs that were vibrant and had extraordinary music. And I used to go out to the clubs almost every night. I preferred the clubs that catered to gay men because I felt that the environment was freer and I could wear jeans and a t-shirt and dance for hours and not be worried about being harassed or, you know, that I was screaming because I was having such an incredible time and singing at the top of my lungs. And, you know, the music was just extraordinary. And the DJs for me at that time played with a sense of purpose, and that they would start you at a pace where the music was at a sort of a middle beat, and then they would just increase the speed to the music so that they could help you reach a point of rapture or orgasm, and then they would stop and start again, and it would just go on. You know, sort of like the stereotypical black preacher where, you know, he would start you here and move you up here and then drop you down here and start again. And there were also DJs that had a message and you had to figure out what the message was, you know, in the music that they were playing. So I just felt so lucky to have had those moments of pure joy and excellence in the 70s, 80s, a little bit in the 90s, you know, and then maybe once or twice a year now. So, but yeah, I remember those days, I remember those evenings, I remember the mixes of the DJs and the foundation of my love for disco classics in particular started there. And then the epidemic arrived in 1981.
When I guess people who missed out on New York nightlife talk about the 70s and they talk about disco's emergence, a lot of conversations really focus on, I think, Studio 54 and Steve Rubell. What are some other places that do not get enough shine? I know we started the video talking about the Loft and Paradise Garage, but what are some other places of places that people need to know that, you know, people really got their life on that dance floor and great sound systems, great DJs?
For me, it was some of my most favorite dance clubs were Better Days, Ice Palace 57. Yes, the Paradise Garage, the River Club, 12 West, the Saint. So those were some of the clubs that, again, extraordinary music, lighting, sound, and a unison of people on the dance floor who were like almost at times moving as one. And of course, the Paradise Garage. While he's trying to figure it out, may I share? How I think DJs worked to hold people.
I just talked the whole thing and it wasn't there.
Okay, good.
Okay. But what I was saying was I'm very fortunate sometime that I'm really playing for a crowd of people that are coming to see me and they relate to what I play. So I'm just going along that trend and watching what they do and reacting to them. I think that that's the best circumstances and just kind of the way Krishna was describing before, kind of building the crowd. I'm very about that old school way of delivering it with a message and kind of peaking it up and maybe taking it down and bring it back up again. Taking people on a journey. I find that that's what works for me the best.
And with that
known, I wanted to ask you, do you have like a sure shot party starter that you always carry in your crates for most gigs, or if it's not like a 45 or a 12 inch, is there a producer that you really
you
go
know
through,
it's I have a lot in that vein, things that I feel like, okay, I really need to, you know, ramp it up or just start with a bang. There's a bunch of them, but I have to make an assessment of the atmosphere and how I feel. Not every record works for everything. So I don't have an example of this is the sure shot. It usually doesn't work that way. Yeah.
Five disco classics. What is your top five? Or who's in your top five?
The I Need You by Sylvester. And in fact, last week I treated myself to a new tattoo. It's next to Sylvester's signature. And it's the lyric, How I Need You, which is part of the anthem, I Need You by Sylvester, which still to this day makes me cry. Then there's Lady America, Boy Voyage. What Can You Do For Me by LaBelle. Romeo and Juliet by Alec Constantinos, which is 15 minutes long. Five is the mixture of Rumor Has It that goes into I Love You, sung by Donna Summer. And I will tell you that several years ago, I helped to organize a dance party fundraiser, of which Danny was one of the guest DJs. And the proceeds went to three HIV and AIDS service organizations. And I will never forget that he played the beginning of Lady America six times. And the crowd was screaming. Like, all we could do was scream. And I was crying. And I was in the middle of the dance floor. And then he went into the full song. Do you remember that, Danny? Yeah. It was at a club called Score in Miami. But
I probably have done that a few times. But no, it's
oh my God, it's,
you know, the songs on your list are big songs for me that I owe.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And these songs have drama. They're very full. They have a beginning, a peak, and then, you know, an ending. So these songs do not spare any, you know.
Yeah, they evoke a lot of
any
emotion.
Energy on being dramatic, because they all are. Yes, exactly.
What else?
The emergence of disco, and then how disco transitioned, and the emergence of house. So what marked that transition of disco to house
for me,
as far as popular dance music?
You know, the entire 70s was this starting to accept disco until the very end of the 70s, where I think as a business, it went a little over the top, and you know, you started to see Disco Mickey Mouse and Disco Duck, and every rock group had a disco hit. But I think it was a clear target for Disco Sucks, which was the summer of 79. And that was in the summer, and by the winter of 79, disco was already a bad word. And people still were out in the clubs dancing, but you just couldn't say disco. And so they're trying to find something else, but nothing else really captured people for dancing the way disco did. So for a minute, you know, freestyle came along, and then like new wave, and they just weren't clicking the same way. And it was a little too early for hip hop. And house music, I started to hear things that were, you could call them house music, but there was no term house music in, let's say, 1982. And I started to hear things by Boy Jarvis and Timmy Regisford and Paul Simpson, and these early tracks that Now you would call them house music, but back then there was no title, maybe not until 75. But they just sounded like stripped down disco, more for the underground, not where disco really went right for the pop side of things. House music was trying to be a little more underground, and that was a success, was in the underground. And I felt that was the transition period. You had all this like R&B disco on the radio, and I was playing in a roller rink. That was big for them. But I would hear a lot of that stuff in the garage too. And a lot of other people were trying their footing in this 80 to 85 period. You know, it was a lot of change of directions until house music kind of sunk in. Yeah, that was my take on it.
I remember when going to the Paradise Garage in particular in 86, that's when I recall that, you know, the DJs, particularly Larry Levan and David DiPino and Joey Janos, but that's when I remember house music coming in full blast with a layered kind of experience of lots of bass and, you know, and vocals and piano, but it would start off bass and then it kept layering and layering and layering. And so I really appreciated the first couple of years of house music, along mixing in with R&B and disco classics music. And then, of course, house music then ventured out to tribal house and soulful house or spiritual house, and just kind of blossomed into a full mosaic of house music. I am not a big house music fan. However, I do appreciate the contribution of how house music today, and, you know, brings people together of all different races, gender, and sexual identities. It's really quite beautiful to just watch people dance, particularly in the park. And they're all, again, as one, you know, on the dance floor.
Which I think really brings up a great segue to another video that I wanted to play, which comes from the documentary Maestro that we already had in the intro. There's another clip that I would like to play. So I'm gonna ask if you all could mute your mics.
You could be at the garage, whether it was full or empty, and the bass was as tight. I can't even describe the tightness. It was just there. It was punching tight. It was tight. That's the only word I can describe it.
It opened up in 80, because that's when the doors were open to us, because it was predominantly a gay club. And it was very well kept secret for them, but once we got our hands on there and they were able to open the doors to the other walks of life, that's when it became more and more popular, because then they had a Friday and a Saturday night to compete with. There are a few people that we know that were there with us, but they were reluctant to accept what we were doing. I had my issues in the beginning. I was a little homophobic. It was a gay club, and then the people who ran it were gay. But after a while, when you feel like you were there, we were part of that no matter what. I mean, and our friends in the beginning, they said, oh, you got to go into the gay garage, to the gay garage. And that's what they used to call it, the gay garage.
Because there were times I'd go to parties, and I would see tensions flare between straights and gays. It got to a point where management had to make a separation. You know, even though a lot of people are going Fridays, I could be online on a Friday to get my coat to go home, and I could hear people saying, yo, you got to come Saturday. Because Saturday still was the predominantly night. But there was a...
It did not happen at the low. You went to look because you wanted a mixed crowd.
That was more earthy.
You wanted a very mixed crowd. You looked for it. And it was this, it was the one singular, for all of us, whether it was the garage, or loft, or both, it was the one singular experience that has made us what we are today. Changed my life.
Larry influenced so many different people. He brought cultures together, black, white, Hispanic, gay, straight. He brought women and men closer together too, because they would hang out. You know, like you, all of us, I think fag hat maybe started during that time. That was a big thing, to be a fag hat, because if he wasn't, you couldn't get into the garage. So you had to learn how to relate and deal with different people that maybe you was told not to, you know, that they shouldn't be a part of your life. And then all of a sudden you find yourself in this place and you're listening to the best music you've ever heard in your life. And everyone's coming together. It had gotten where everyone had found themselves because they was hanging out in this place where you could be yourself and you could be fabulous.
The loft and the gallery, and places like that, that when you see that there's so many people that are like you and like the same things, all you know is that you found a place that you really enjoy being at, and you love the surroundings and everything that's going on there, you know, and what people, how the whole experience makes you feel. You know, it's good to be able to have that, you know what I mean, because hopefully it helps them to get to that next level, you know, in dealing with their own lives, you know, with everything else. You know what I mean? It's so much easier for them now, you know, because it's so widely accepted, but back then it just, it was very difficult.
So thinking about the video, and thinking about what they were talking about being able to assemble various groups of people under one roof for one common cause. Wanted to know, I guess start with Krishna and then we go with Danny, about what does it take to facilitate and sustain an environment that is diverse, that has so many people of different backgrounds, but people all having a good time.
The DJ who is generous, who is watching the people on the dance floor, who is willing to take people, as Danny said, on a journey, and not being afraid that people are gonna, you know, hit those points of rapture and be just, you know, in pure joy. This was especially helpful when in 1981, when the beginning of the AIDS epidemic started. And so I would go to the dance clubs hoping for that spiritual divine connection with other people and trusting that the DJ would take me on a journey so that I could grieve for the people that were, you know, were dying or had died of AIDS, and that I could have my own memorial service, but I could also be filled with joy and rapture and healing. And so to this day, when I go to a couple of, you know, like I said, once or twice a year, if I'm lucky, I go to a dance party where they play predominantly disco classics music. What happens is you will see people just so happy to be there, but also crying. I cry when I'm on the dance floor. And it's because I'm so filled with happiness, but I also miss my friends. I miss the DJs, I miss the singers, I miss the staff, the owners of the clubs who've all died of AIDS. And so it's like going to a faith community, and it still is for me, and I'm so grateful. But it does require the talents of the DJ, who is like, come with me, and that the people on the dance floor are willing to go with the DJ and hear his music. Like, I'm listening to the mixes. That's how old I am. So, and I know what's coming up, and I'm like, oh my God, you know? So, yeah.
Crowds, how did you, and how was the environment sustained to bring so many people from different backgrounds together for one common cause? you know, whether you were in the loft or the Paradise Garage or a gallery or a Saint, how did you bring folks together and what was needed or what was necessary?
You know, I think
to bring so many people together.
At the base of all this with the music, it's always been a positive message. So I always felt that when I'm taking on this journey with this message, it pulls more and more people together. And the more they sustain, like, doing this all together, you know, for a while, the more they come together as a group. And they're not just this separate, you know, group of people. They're kind of come together as one. And it's funny, you know, even me being on the other end of this, when you leave a party and that's happened, you feel like you went there and you might not know these people, but by the end, you're kind of part of this community. And it wasn't just the songs, it was experiencing them all together, which is, you know, a lot of these songs about love and all these positive messages. So it's very uplifting, at least mm-hmm. for me and the places I go and what I choose to play. That's how I see it.
Yeah, and also the music, at least the music that I love, lends itself to be like an orchestra, like a symphony, and the DJ is the maestro. So because of the way that disco classics in particular, you know, the way that the music, the songs itself were, constructed. So, you know, whether it's First Choice or some of the other, you know, songs that I mentioned, you knew that you could start with First Choice and then go someplace, you know, because the music was that outstanding and soulful and rich
for sure.
And sexy and meaningful.
And thinking about HIV and thinking about the epidemic, especially in the early 80s, do you recall your earliest memory of HIV and how it was affecting friends, loved ones, and community members?
Well, if we were talking, you know, in particular about the dance clubs and the dance music industry, what was happening for me is that I would go to a club and you would see the bartenders that I knew. I would come back to the club the next time and they were gone. And so it was like a quiet hurricane going through and wiping people out. And then you hear that this DJ died, and then, you know, the lighting designer died, and then, you know, and it just kept increasing, just like a hurricane as it's traveling up the coast, you know. And then it was like Sylvester died, and Sharon Redd, and Dan Hartman, and it was just devastating. The first ever AIDS fundraiser occurred at the Paradise Garage. It was a party called Showers. It was in 1983 and benefited Gay Men's Health Crisis, the first HIV and AIDS service organization in the world. And so there it is. And so the dance music industry and the clubs started to unite and become, in many ways, activists, you know, to do what all that they could to raise money and to lift up those that were dying. Like Mike Brody, the owner of the Paradise Garage, died in 1987, which was when the club closed. And then Mel Sharon, the late Mel Sharon, he continued having parties where the DJs would play music from 1976 to 1987, which a few still do, and they became fundraisers. So so the activism was united with the music. and in the spirit of the clubs and the people who died of AIDS. And so it is still a very powerful tool to bring people together, to energize or re-energize people, that the work, you know, around HIV and AIDS is still not over. But I just, at one point, I went to too many memorial services, and I got tired, emotionally tired. So going to a dance club and being able to start the evening off going, who am I dancing for? And then dancing for hours nonstop became a way of having my own memorial services.
I relate to that very closely. It seemed very similar in the sense that I would go to the club and next time I go, someone else would be gone. It was like a hurricane. Mm-hmm. But you know, I always found that clubs and the music itself was always this great place to celebrate, but it was also a great place to escape. And whether I was upset about this or had something that was depressing me, a lot of people around me were disappearing. I might think of that when I walk in the door and this person's gone or someone tells me about this, but I got to run out to the dance floor and get it out of my system. So it was a great way to work it out. And at the same time, I'm there in that community and with my friends feeling the same way and feeling good afterwards. Like, okay, it's not like we just forgot about something. It's more we're getting through it.
Mm-mm. Yeah. And when Mel Sharon, who was one of the financiers of the garage, and his ex-lover was Mike Brody, and they stayed friends. But when Mel died of AIDS-related complications in 2007, in his will, he bequeathed the Paradise Garage trademark to GMHC, because he wanted the trademark to be forever connected to AIDS activism and HIV and AIDS fundraising. And so it has been an honor and an oftentimes hard work to manage this trademark. And when I wear my Paradise Garage t-shirts, it's like I'm wearing my heart, you know, on the cover of my shirt. So, the music still holds all of that incredible power to keep people moving forward, because, you know, we still have people living with HIV and AIDS. People are still contracting HIV. We still have HIV-related stigma. So the music,
yeah, for sure,
you know, keeps us going.
Possible for those who are listening who may not know, what is the GMHC, Gay Men's Health Crisis?
So, Gay Men's Health Crisis, also known as GMHC, is the first HIV and AIDS service organization in the world. The first meeting, ironically, is of our six founders, was on August 11th, 1981. So tomorrow we mark Founders Day. And six gay men and their supporters and friends came together in one of our founders' living room, Larry Kramer, who died in May of this year, and they put together the first funds to start what became Gay Men's Health Crisis. And currently, we serve about 13,000 men, women, and families living with and affected by HIV and AIDS. We have a wide variety of services, care services for people living with HIV and AIDS, as well as HIV prevention programs. We have a testing center, we do public policy advocacy, and our fundraisers include dance parties. have to put that in there. So I've been a part of GMHC as an employee for 27 years, and I started as a volunteer in 1986. So one of my most favorite fundraisers was the AIDS Dance-a-thon, which started in the in the 1990s, and to see 10,000 people dancing for a purpose was just outstanding. So gmhc.org is where you'll find us.
Thank you. And thinking about, you know, we've dropped a few names along the way. Wanted to also give you all the space and the time to give out some shout outs to whether it was the bartenders, DJs, light technicians, folks that really contributed to those really great nights of escapism and relief and those internal memorial services that you were having on the dance floor. You know, just in the tradition of saying their names, whether, like I said, whether they're DJs or whomever, anyone that you want to give a shout out to?
Danny, you want to go first? All right, well, should I go then? Frankie Houlihan, DJ, Jim Burgess, Roy Thodes, Larry Levan, T. Scott, Warren Gluck, who died a few months ago, Mike Brody, oh, man, Sylvester, singer, Sharon Redd, Dan Hartman, Paul Jabara, I'll stop there. Thank you. And Robbie Leslie is still alive, so we thank him too. And Trevor Fox and Danny Krivit.
Certainly Larry Levan and Dave Mancuso, miss them both. T. Scott and Mel Sharon, Jonathan Faring.
Yes, Mel Sharon.
Trying to think, a lot of the names that Keisha mentioned. Just for all the people that we're missing right now.
Mm-hmm. And for that, it's important to lift up people's names, especially those who are no longer here, but they've had contributions and they've had positive impact on our lives. So thank you. And there's so many other folks, right? And I think that's the purpose of the New York City AIDS Memorial, to keep those names alive and make sure that they live beyond their pulse. I wanted to also ask, especially Krishna, but I think this is like Krishna and Danny conversation question, would be, as director of community relations and planning fundraisers and parties, what or how or what strategy do you think is best to engage DJs and music lovers in raising more awareness around HIV and some of the roundabout services like housing, employment, stigma?
Well, I think it's important when I reach out to DJs, and certainly Danny in years past has been a part of the team of DJs who would donate their time for these fundraisers, is for them to understand, first of all, what, you know, GMAC does, or what an HIV and AIDS service organization does, who we serve, why it's important for DJs to be a part of fundraising, because they are, in my mind, activists. I mean, activism comes in many different forms. And so through creativity, through art, through politics, through music, you know, I mean, there's not one way to be an activist. And so, and DJs bring people together, And that's what we need, because we have to continue with the work, you know, when we're talking about Black Lives Matter, trans lives matter, you know, LGBT folks, you know, and their rights, human rights, fighting against, you know, gun violence, all of those moments, those causes intersect with each other. We're not just working in silos. They all interact with the epidemic, the COVID-19 pandemic, which we're battling as well. So it's, you know, it's not one or the other. It's all of those causes that we are trying to address, you know, in terms of human rights and social justice issues. So that's why DJs are important, because they are leaders in our community and people look up to them and they live for them and they live for the music. So it makes perfect sense to have them be a part of the experience of raising much.
Yeah, well, I'm always ready to support and hopefully, you know, enlist others.
I want to say thank you so much for your time today. Thank you for your patience with technical issues, and just thank you so much, like, even working out the logistics and responding to my email, because little old me. So thank you, Danny. Thank you, Krishna. I really appreciate it. And
thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Dave Harper from New York City AIDS Memorial.
And before we wrap up, I wanted to know what you all are working on. How are you all taking care of yourself, and maybe how people can follow you and follow your movements and know more about what, you know, what you got
right.
going on?
Thank you both. It's a pleasure working both of you. Let's see, for me, the DJing is slowed down right now. I can't DJ, but I am working in a lot of music. So one of my big things is editing. And I have a lot of music coming out. I have a new website, Danny Krivit. DK Edits, Mr. K Edits. .com, and that's a lot of my edits are out on that. And that's how I'm getting by. It's just kind of waiting, you know, probably the end of this year. See how things get through. You know, just staying in the music, that's what keeps me alive. I love music. And that's it for me.
And for us at GMHC, we're about to move into a season of fundraisers, and they will most likely be virtual fundraisers. So that a lot of the community events that I worked on, and certainly fundraisers, have been virtual, and most likely they will continue in that realm, you know, until the end of the year. We have tomorrow, Tuesday, August 11th, we will be acknowledging our 6 founders of Gay Men's Health Crisis, which is a very powerful moment for us. Certainly at the end of the year, we have World AIDS Day, which is on December 1st. So there will be community events as well. And in between there, I hope there's some dance parties, fundraisers, and we will just keep on dancing. We've got a lot of work to continue to do.
And so any final thoughts from you all that we want to get out there? Any questions I didn't ask that, you know, the information needs to be put out there? Final remarks?
No, I'm good. I just happy to have this talk with both of you. And I think you covered quite a bit.
I agree. I don't think it's often enough that I have the pleasure to talk about dancing and the music that is important to me. And so it's a gift, and I appreciate your thinking of me, Stephen. I think that the more that we can have these kinds of dialogues about the way that we are activists, the way that we move in these times of epidemics and pandemics and social unrest, that these conversations are very uplifting, and they certainly are life-sustaining for me and others.
Cool.
And on a really high note, yes, and see if we can play Lady America.
Oh!
So, and then for those who are listening, please check out the New York City AIDS Memorial. Check them out, you know, go on the internet, and there's more to come. And like I said, this is a series of episodes. So this is episode 3, I believe, and we have way more in store. And so thank you all for listening, and thank you all for attending. And just want to say peace, love, take care, and be healthy.
Take care.